session. Oh, should I say that again? Welcome everyone to this evening's session. My name is Sekai Makoni and I'm gonna be hosting the evening tonight for you in person and online. We're giving verbal descriptions. So I'm a light-skinned black woman whose hair is in a braided bun and I'm wearing a black and white outfit. And we're making sure we do this so that those who are visually impaired or blind can access what we're doing tonight. I also go by the pronouns she, her. So a bit about me. I'm an artist, workshop facilitator, and radio host based in Rotterdam with particular expertise on race, identity, black feminism, and decoloniality. And I'll be holding the space for us tonight. A lot of my work focuses on the importance of active listening. And tonight, I invite us to take this as an opportunity to hear from others without interruption. So we're not gonna be taking a Q&A from the public, but we'll be having a dialogue between ourselves that you get to witness. Just a bit of the running order. I'm going to introduce each of our speakers. We'll have an opening exercise from Marina. We will hear from our speakers, and then there'll be a discussion between the panelists, followed by a closing summary and a short film. We welcome you today in the context of Dancing in Your Shoes, which is the third edition of the European project Performing Gender, which is a three-year audience development project aimed at developing a bond between cultural professionals and their local communities in the field of dance and performing arts through a discussion on gender, LGBTQIA plus identities. And today, the overarching question we asked our speakers to reflect on is how do artists navigate the relationship between their personal identity or identities and their artistic practice? Firstly, we have Marina Santo, who graduated in history with a specialism in education, arts, culture, and citizenship. And she began training in classical ballet at an early age in Rio de Janeiro, moving to jazz, and as an adult into contemporary dance, movement research, and the connection between somatic practices and dance. She has developed a lengthy career as a dancer and performer with a solid experience as a body dance movement educator. And she's created her own educational project since 2010, working as a teacher with various profiles of communities, women, youth, LGBTQIA, POC, and diaspora, teachers from public schools, and many others. So in 2023, she was selected among 168 artists to develop her dance project through the program Art for Change, and also Beyond the Skin, which is a dance piece resulting from a series of workshops offered by her to POC and diaspora community residents in Madrid. So can we welcome Marina, please? Would you be able to give us your gender pronouns and a quick visual description of yourself as well?
Yes.
Yeah?
Oh, well, I identify myself as she, her, and I am a cis woman, Afro-Brazilian, light skin. I am much browner than what I am right now because it's almost winter, and I'm wearing a very green dress and watermelon earrings.
Love it. Thank you so much. So next up, we have Bakani Pickup. And Bakani is a choreographer, movement artist, and improvisation practitioner. As well as creating their own work, they have performed nationally and internationally in works by Theo Klinkard, Anthea Hamilton, and Fevered Sleep. And with practice as research at the core of their work, they explore decolonization through dance practice, haptic visuality, and choreographic research. Bakani is the artistic director of Bakani Pickup Company, and they are based in Leeds, England. So could I have a round of applause for Bakani, please? And can I also get your gender pronouns and a visual description of yourself?
Yeah. My pronouns are he, they. My description is I currently have very, very short hair, could be seen as having no hair. I have dark brown skin and a bit of a beard, very short beard. And I'm wearing a white t-shirt and black trousers, and I'm of slightly stocky build.
Beautiful. I'm going to hand over to you, Marina, for a little grounding exercise, and then we'll go straight into your talk.
Yep.
Brilliant.
Don't worry, you don't need to move from your seats. And I just, you know, want to invite all of us to do a little journey together here and now. And just close your eyes, everybody. And take a moment to enjoy the feeling of perceiving your body and the sensations blooming inside you. There is no right or wrong. Just take this moment to feel yourself. And then start paying attention to the air that comes in and out from your nose. Enjoy your own presence there. And connect with the space under your navel. Enjoy the flow of the waves there. Start connecting as well with the space where your heart is. Can you feel the samba grooving there? Pay attention to the contact you have with the floor, of your seat. Let yourself feel the support. Without support, there's no possibility of movement. Stay a little bit more there. And then slowly, I would like us to come back and open our eyes and let the things appear in front of us. Feel the light, the space. Check it out, how you're feeling right now. And let's connect everybody breathing in together. And let's breathe out with a noise. Thank you. Well, for me, it's really interesting to start talking about the body, connecting with the body. You know, we are in a formal situation, somehow sitting and talking, and there's lots of expectations what she's going to say. So actually, I could stop here and go, but I'm going to speak a little bit. When I was thinking about the theme of this meeting here, I thought about a fragment of a text from Audre Lorde, amazing Afro-American cis woman, lesbian, professor, philosopher, intersectional feminist, poet, and civil rights activist. And she said, "What separates us is not our differences, but the resistance to recognizing those differences and confronting the distortions that result from ignoring and misinterpreting them. When we define ourselves, when I define myself, and I define the space in which I am like you and the space I am not like you, I'm not denying the contact between us, nor am I excluding you from the contact. I'm actually expanding our contact place." So I take this quote as my starting point to talk about my personal identity, identities, and my artistic practice. Well, I have been dancing since I can remember. In the oldest memory I have of myself, I am dancing the carnival in Rio de Janeiro, Brazil, my hometown. And dance has been a big part of my life. But I didn't dare to do it professionally because of economical reasons. So I studied history in university, and I truly believed by the time I became, if I became a history teacher, I could be part of a political revolution in Brazil. The idea of changing structures has always been a very important part of who I am. My personal identity and artistic practice are totally connected in my body, which is exactly the place where dance happens. I am an Afro-Brazilian cis woman, mom of a little kid, and I have been living 20 years in Europe as an immigrant from the global south. My relationship with contemporary dance has been mostly connected with alternative and experimental spaces outside the structured and well-recognized cool dance world. As a performer, I have danced in some prestigious spaces, but as I've never had access to formal dance education and had to work very hard, doing many other jobs outside the artistic field in order to be able to pay my bills and keep dancing, I always felt that I really didn't belong to the artistic class. If we consider activism as the effort to promote actions and practices with the desire to make changes in ourselves, in people, in society, toward a perceived greater good, my answer is yes. I consider my artistic practice as activism. At the same time, I think activism is a concept that has been so stereotyped that I wonder if it could somehow tag or limit my artistic practices. As Clarice Lispector said, an outstanding Brazilian writer, I recommend you, she said, freedom is not enough for me. What I really want is still unnamed. Dance is disruptive. The practice of dancing itself is subversive for several reasons. One, because it's a nonverbal language and therefore questions the dominance of the world. Two, because the temporality of the body practices, they are counterproductive to the capitalist system. Three, because enjoyment and celebration become revolutionary in a system that only wants us to work. Let's not forget, if the society is racist, the cultural system is also racist. Therefore, our practice should at least point at these structures. We must also horizontalize the resources for those bodies and practices assumed as amateur or non-professional. Many of those bodies assumed as amateurs are so because maybe they have not had access to professional spaces. Let's not perpetuate a hierarchy that divides artists from non-artists. Often, one significant flaw in the community art projects is that the artist feels disconnected or not identified with the individuals they collaborate with. So how I became part of Performing Gender? I was invited to give some sessions to this amazing group, and the experience went so well that I was invited to stay as a dance maker together with Javier Vaquero, an amazing human being that defines herself as a dancer, transvestite, and multifaceted worker forced by capitalism. I felt much more embraced in the LGBTQIA+ community than in some white feminist spaces I've participated in previously. I will take with me a set of unforgettable experiences and beautiful connections with the participants. I feel really honored to witness their development through dance. The amount of new things I've learned and continue to learn has been revolutionary as a person and as a professional. It makes me think about all the connections and similarities between us, outsiders and marginalized communities. I felt really supported. Outsiders learning and dancing together. What an experience. Artistically, Performing Gender gave me strength to really dare to put my ideas out there. I look right. And avoiding this imposter feeling syndrome I always had, I gained lots of self-esteem. And when I think about the role of the artist in the society, I honestly think that an artist should live with dignity. That's our role. Be happy, work, pay your taxes, be free. And then, when we reach this point, we can ask ourselves about the transcendence and moving up the ladder. I am forever energized and inspired doing what I do because I have discovered in the arts a space where I can authentically be myself and connect with others on a profound level, awakening myself and other individuals to our own humanity. Artists have the ability to showcase alternative approaches to living in the world, and that means a lot. When I'm asked about intersectionality, I feel that, it's a very trendy concept in the policymaking, but personally, I believe that, with some exceptions, it's a concept that people like to mention, but without really practicing it and integrate it into their lives. Individuals who has always had the privileges and priorities in accessing work, having visibility, and holding economic power need to step back and allow others to take these spaces. That means including non-white, non-European, non-male, non-able-bodied, non-cisgender, occupying positions of power within the institutions and projects that allow us to make decisions and, by consequence, transform what is needed. Unfortunately, I often see people reacting defensively when, for example, their anti-racism policies or practices are questioned. In order to be constructive, here are some suggestions. Use your privilege to access to power to create spaces and platforms for visibility for marginalized groups. Convert your privilege into a potential alliance. In addition to this, the key characteristics that I see essential in all kinds of projects and organizations is one based on caregiving. We need healthy and nurturing spaces for processes of sharing and feeling supported to have a balanced mental health. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. My name is Bakani Pickup. I was born in Bulawayo, Zimbabwe. My parents are Ephraim Pickup and Samgeli Somoy. They too were born in Zimbabwe, except in their time, it was known as Rhodesia, a colony named after Cecil John Rhodes. I come from a big family, which comes with its own love and its own complexities. I assume this is where my fascination with the eclectic nature of community stems from. It is this thread that I recognize in my work. Bit of background about how I got here today. At some point, my father got ill and later died. As a consequence of his illness, I followed my mother to England. I left my home without knowing it was forever. When we arrived in England, we lived in a small town in Hampshire called Borden, a beautiful and extremely complex home. I was not familiar with British communities and found myself jumping from people to people. It is here, through them, I learned about Britishness. In this small town, I was supported and encouraged to dance and perform. They set me on this path, altering my life. They did so through care and endorsement, through community. Since moving to the UK, I have lived in Borden, Cornwall, London, Nottingham, Cardiff, and now Leeds. Each home has come with its own communities and complexities. It is perhaps also through this I feel that each community needs its individual consideration. It is perhaps unwise to assume that we all require the same care and to be seen in the same way. I was raised by a single mother who was simultaneously supporting us and a family back home in Zimbabwe. Through sharing an environment with a person so caring, I learned that this was the way I want to be. Someone who can do something for others, offer care the only way I know how, through dance. But not just any dance, but something that allows us to connect to joy and pleasure, to find space to express ourselves and take care of each other. I must also acknowledge the hand my sister has played in my life. She's a therapeutic counselor. She has taught me about the small ways we can show up for people. She once said to me that she sees our jobs as the same. She helps people through offering space for them to talk, and I, in her eyes, help people through offering them space to dance. And with that in mind, I take this honor of holding space with the utmost care and responsibility. Dance to me is a wonder, a unique joy. I learned to dance in Zimbabwe, so to me, it is a part of my culture, it is a part of who I am, and so it feels quintessential to allow this part of myself to exist. At times of feeling lost and disconnected and being an immigrant in a completely new world, the one thing that stayed with me and that would later become even more apparent is that whether in Zimbabwe or England, dance inevitably brings people together. I don't know what kind of a person I would be without the things dance has taught me about myself and about other people. To be black and queer and immigrant and be able to find sanctuary amongst places and people is only something you can truly appreciate by living through it and maybe, perhaps, with the most intent listening. Along my career, I've had the most fortunate experience of working with people who have been kind and nurturing. They have taught me that dance can be so much more than entertainment or a spectacle. It can speak to the emotions that are not attached to words. Catherine Hall, a dance artist, wrote, "Can choreography be an act of care?" This resonated with me. It resonated to the feeling that dance offers that isn't centered in showcase, but in empathy. It is also this role I recognize in my upbringing. My mother, a carer, someone with endless amounts of passion for looking after people and making them feel loved. How might my role as a facilitator take this way of being with me into the studio? It is here I have found my improvisational practice. Improvisation to me is not about codified technique. It is embodied knowledge that rises to the surface from a particular stimulus, whether a song or a score or a need. It comes from a feeling and a want, and is also important to realize the power that lies in being able to do with your body as you please. I have been part of performing gender with Yorkshire Dance since 2021. Admittedly, a newbie to the city at the time, but through Company of People, our performance group for this program, through their experiences and their stories, I feel like I have been in Leeds all my life and joined a family that has come together to dance. I've had firsthand experience in seeing the power of dance. This is something perhaps you cannot measure in profit or product, but something even more important in the way it makes people feel. The youngest in our group is 13, and the oldest is 83. We have all taken turns looking after each other, and we have all cried and danced together. In Zulu or Ndebele, we say, "Umuntu ngumuntu ngabantu." It means a person is only a person through or because of others. I am part of many marginalized communities. It is here I have seen what happens when we are not more thoughtful and more caring. But it is also these communities that have taught me that above all else, it is important to have space where we can be ourselves. Community isn't about conformity or whether or not we are all the same, although this can be the case. But I would argue it is more about individuals coming together and inserting a piece of themselves to build and perhaps hold each other with well intentions. A bit like a rainbow. A rainbow is a rainbow because of all its different colors, not because it is one. So, I conclude. It is the longest and most extravagant journey that I have been on that has brought me here today. The biggest takeaway, I suppose, is that more than anything, I am the result of a child raised by a whole village. Many communities have embraced me and allowed me to be the person I feel is the truest. In this sake, the truest thing to me is to be liberated, to be a caring person and a caring artist. I wish to see all the communities I have learned to love reflected in the eclectic nature of dance. A few years ago, a retired gentleman from a working class community who, by his own admission, didn't dance, found himself in one of our community workshops. At the end, he came up to us and said, "It is things like this that make life worth living." And I agree. To dance is the ultimate medicine for the soul. To dance is to be able to liberate yourself through movement and pleasure. We all dance. The difference is about who is allowed and who is not. I believe that you can learn a lot about the condition of a human being when you give them space to connect to their sense of truth. How do we hold space for this? How might we improve the quality of our lives? I suppose by bringing a part of ourselves and by being welcoming, we may find some of the most nuanced ways of being that change our lives for the better. From Bulawayo to Borden to Belgium. Thank you.
Well, first of all, thank you so much to all of you for those really interesting and quite emotional discussions, I think. What I thought was really interesting was the ways in which each of you kind of spoke to care in a way, that the work that you do through dance speaks to that. And I wonder if you could, like, maybe, and whoever wants to take this, but talk about how you consider care outside of the way that I think that care has really become a bit of a buzzword within kind of artistic spaces. And I don't know how far it's always necessarily really being done. So I was just wondering if, especially you two who are doing projects within performing gender, if you could give some examples of where you've really seen that care come to life in the work that you're doing, be it in relation to you or the people you're working with. I know you were saying there's someone from 13 all the way up until 83, so that kind of intergenerational element. Well, also I thought was really interesting was where you were speaking about LGBTQIA spaces and how in some ways you felt more welcome in those spaces. So yeah, broadly, if or how does care cater into the artistic practice or dance practice that you do? And whoever feels like they want to go first is...
Go first.
I'm still catching my breath.
Okay. I'll give like two landscapes.
Yeah.
When talking about myself, when I mentioned this affinity and similarities with the LGBTQ community, is that I've never felt questioned. I've never felt when I bring an example of an experience, a bad experience I have in the streets, because the streets are really violent to a non-white body. And I'm not going to do like a pornography of pain here and telling all the stories I have, because I have too many. Far too many. But I feel like no one ever says, really? Has this ever happened to you? Like in other spaces are constantly, I have like to justify, and it's super violent. To almost have to prove to people that you go through these things, I don't need that. And this community I've never, it's like, you're here, you know, you're together, you know? So it's like really something. And talking about the community itself, there are some moments that were really challenging because the community is very diverse itself. People come from Spain, people that don't come from Spain, people that has papers, people that don't have papers, people that have work, people that don't have work. So it's like, and you could see in some moments where someone was in a very, very, very vulnerable moment. In the life and in the moment of the year, like the end of the year, it's quite sensitive. And the community organized themselves to embrace this person and offer this person a place to stay. So I felt like, wow, you know, it's amazing that in the same way that in the streets we can now suffer so much violence for being no white or for being non-cisgender, at the same time, you have someone here in this bubble, in this like treating each other like humans, and you need help, I help you. So and it's quite amazing.
What do you think allowed for that? Like, what created that environment? Was it the people that came? Was it the tone that was set? Like, how did that emerge?
I find hard to like give a recipe because it's a day by day work. We a team of people really focus, and it's hard to. To say safe space because it's also a very trendy word right now, but really give the space for us to really get to know each other and to build a trust. And because there's not anything to prove, we're just there, we're there to be big B together. So I think it opens a space in the hearts for people to soft in, and then the beauty comes. Without a space, a context, a framework, it would be impossible, I think.
Thank you. Bakani, do you wanna?
Yeah, yes. So I guess for me, it's considering care is not one thing. I think we all consider that. I think through watching my sister, I think these are real world examples that have really helped me, people that live in the real world, so to speak, that are kind of on the ground, caring for people on a day by day basis. How does this way of being leak into everything else? If I see the way my mother creates and puts time and effort into a care plan for for someone who has dementia, for example, how do I embody those qualities? How do I learn from that way of really being there for people and taking responsibility in the same way maybe my sister also sits and talks to people? And I think maybe in particular to my sister, she's someone that talks to a lot of people that have experienced quite heavy life experiences. Mm-hmm. So then also there comes this point of recognizing what her level of care is to be able to be suitable enough to be there to care for other people. This is something that also applies to my choreographic practice. When I go into a room or a studio and I'm working with people, how can I ensure other people are okay if I'm not okay? And so there is a lot about really thinking about what care is in those instances. The people that need care from my mother are different people that need care from my sister, who are different people that need care for me. So it's not really about taking this one way, this care package, and just being like, right, you all have to get something out of this, and if you don't, well, then maybe you're on your own. And I think a lot of people get left behind when that happens. So it's also this thing of being, how do we constantly stay adaptable? And I think for me, you know, like you're saying with Grace, she's 13, you know, she can run anywhere across the building, she can do whatever she wants. And then we have someone who's 83 who can't do that. So their levels of care are completely different. So also watching the facilitator, the lead choreographer of our company of people, TC Howard, make adaptions to ensure that everyone gets to have an experience. We don't all have to have the same experience because we're not all the same. In the same way, we don't all need the same type of care because we're not all the same. And I think being part of a community, a diverse community, has really helped me understand that also my needs are completely valid. And sometimes through dance training or through the arts, or I don't know what it is, but there is this sense of we must always be resilient. And sometimes that resilience actually means just not taking time to care for yourself because you have to keep going, you have to keep going on and on. And so realizing that when you're, you know, when I'm in these communities, it doesn't work to be resilient because you will hurt people if you just keep going and going and going, and understanding that I will get hurt if I don't also prioritize time to be able to do the thing that I need. And so I suppose care is also about being able to know what your needs are and to listen to what other people's needs are as well. But then also taking responsibility. I was thinking of a question that was proposed a couple of weeks ago in that, what are you as a facilitator, as a holder of space, responsible for? But then also, what do you feel responsible for? And recognizing that those are not the same things.
Super interesting. Yeah, thank you. I wanted to ask, I would argue that what all of you said, what I heard from it, is that your personal identities do impact your artistic practice. And arguably, I don't think it's possible to separate the two. And jumping off what you were saying around like the white gaze and voyeurism, I wonder how you think about if you yourself, your personal identity is part of your artistic practice and your dance practice, when you are working with communities, and I'd also argue in communities, how do you navigate your position as potentially, I don't know, leading some choreography, but also sharing perhaps a marginalized identity with that group? How do you navigate being of with the communities that you work with? Because sometimes how the projects are positioned is that there's an outside expert that comes in to do work to the community. And I wonder how you do work with the community, with an understanding, hopefully, that you are part of those communities too. If anyone wants to pick that up.
So as part of the Dancing in Your Shoes program. I was one of, so what we did, what Yorkshire Dance did, is that certain artists that were part of the program was kind of went into specific communities mm-hmm. to do workshops and lead sessions with them and then invite them to join Company of People. Mm-hmm. And so the group that I was working with was a group called House of Flavor, mm-hmm. Which is a queer, trans, intersex, indigenous people of color group. Mm-hmm. And that was actually a very interesting experience for me. Because there was also somewhat this idea that it's a group of people of color, mm-hmm. and so there is a different state of being in that is maybe slightly more relaxed mm-hmm. or less curated for assimilation or whatever other reasons. And then also in that environment, just realizing that, oh no, There is still so much consideration. Mm-hmm. There is POC, people of color or black people, et cetera, also becomes an umbrella term mm-hmm. That groups a bunch of people who are actually all unique in their own ways together. And I think for me, it was also this sense of realizing that about my identity, of where do I sit along that spectrum? Mm-hmm. And the answer was kind of like interesting, because then this spectrum of existence of people is beyond anything that I thought existed, beyond anything that you see on TV, mm-hmm. beyond the stereotypes. Mm-hmm. And there was something quite revealing about those identities, because you can never know. Mm-hmm. You can never know people. And sometimes you can prepare mm-hmm. and kind of bring all your stuff together and be like, this is what it's going to be. And then, you know, someone's like, actually, I'm not okay with this. This makes me feel this uncomfortable, mm-hmm. but it feels important to your culture, mm-hmm. to your heritage, to your way of being. Mm-hmm. So part of this ongoing dialogue is also, how do you, A, respect people's boundaries? Mm-hmm. How do you state what your boundaries are? Mm-hmm. But more importantly, how do you navigate boundaries in a group? And these are very, very complex things that you continue to dig out all the time. I continue to dig out all the time with no true answer, because any one or two groups are different from each other. And so what do I have to hold on to when I go into those spaces? My sense of self. Mm-hmm. And that becomes the most important thing. Like, who am I as a human being? What are things that are important to me? Treating people right, mm-hmm. being a caring person, mm-hmm. being flexible. Mm-hmm. All of these things are part of my personal identity. Mm-hmm. And so when I come into the space, these then begin to feel like elements that can be utilized to allow for, I suppose, a better navigation of identities and multiple identities in a space, even in a community when you're all the same.
Mm, for sure. I'm aware that we need to wrap up soon, but I want to see that if you also had a reflection that you wanted to share.
I feel like, as I mentioned before, as I've never felt like the artist, mm-hmm. and I have been working with communities in the last 13 years. So when I come to work with the community, for me, it's like we are, it can sound a little cliche, but I really feel that we are researching together. I am making, I am accompanying, is it right English? Mm-hmm. Accompagnar. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so then to discover a body language, to embrace the sensorial anatomy. I'm not teaching steps. I work with what I have, what we discover together. So I don't feel that there is this imbalance in me and them. I don't feel that. Mm-hmm. With this specific community of the performing gender, I was, in the beginning, I was really clear, okay, I'm coming here because I am an immigrant, not white, but I am in a heterosexual relationship. I am a mom. I know I'm going to teach about, you know, talk about race, talking about this and body. And then was this surprise in the research that, oh, there's so much in common. Oh my goodness, we're really in the same boat. So if I had before this feeling that I feel so comfortable working with the community because of my life history, with this community of performing genders, it was like a plus, like, wow. Apart from that, look how much more, how many other things in common I have. When I work only with the diaspora community, people of color community, I feel that I have this feeling of being so glued because it's so me that I want to play God sometimes and I want to do everything and I want to help everybody. And there comes the mom on me, like, my goodness, justice, you know, reparación, I have to do everything. And I'm also learning that I need to respect my own time because as a facilitator, I don't know how you want to, a dance maker or whatever you want to call it, you also have to take care of yourself. That's really amazing what you said, Bakani, because we are together. We are in the same frame, you know. So I don't know if I answered your question, but it made me think. And I don't know. Yeah?
Perfect. We're literally almost out of time already. We're almost hitting the hour. I just want to give a quick summary. So I really appreciate hearing from each of your perspectives. Hearing from you, Marina, I really love the way that you kind of jumped off from Audre Lorde, and we learn about your kind of experiences in Brazil to Brussels and your work with performing gender. And Parvin, like hearing about the ways in which you've kind of explored moving from Iran to here and moving from visual arts to performing arts and how that impacts your work has been brilliant. And Bakani, hearing as well about your experiences in Zimbabwe, like me, it's been really beautiful. And also, I hear within that the black women in your circles, your mother, your sister, who really influence how you, you know, approach your work. I think it's really important. I want to say a very big thank you to Creative Europe and the Performing Gender Partners. We really appreciate all of the support. We're going to close out with a video, I believe. If that's gonna, yeah. So if I can have a round of applause for our panelists. Thank you.
Thank you to you as well. Thank you.
And I think we'll have the video now.
I like dancing.